Okay. And today we are looking at advanced microeconomics, and we are looking at market structure, and we are focusing on perfect market. Now, what's a perfect market? Of course, everybody knows that a perfect market is a market where you have many buyers and many sellers selling homogeneous products, and there is free entry and exit. Now, I have told you in economics, anytime you are looking at, anytime you hear the word market, what should come to your head is business. A type of business that anybody can start it at any time, and anybody can stop doing it at any time. And that business that person is doing, so many people are doing it, and so many people patronize the business. That's what we call perfect market. E.g., look at people selling pure water. The pure water, people selling pure water are so many. People buying pure water are so many, and pure water are the same. Most people that buy pure water, you hardly look at, what's the name of the pure water? Is it Queenette pure water or Toby pure water before I buy? Most people don't check. So any market or business that operate that way is what we call perfect market. That is, the goods are the same, they are homogeneous. So if you get to where you want to buy pure water, you will hardly say, give me Queenette pure water. But you know, if you want to buy phone, you can say, give me Samsung, or give me this one. So that one is monopolistic market, business of food. But when it comes to business of something like bread, pure water, so most of the time you have many people doing the business, many people patronizing them, and the good are homogeneous. That's what you call perfect. And then some people used to say, every time I hear the word perfect, it means that market is so perfect. No. This perfect, they brought it from the curve. The curve. There's what we call perfectly elastic. A demand is said to be perfectly elastic when the price is constant and quantity changes. The price is constant and quantity changes. Or put it in a better way, a type of product that you buy, that what determines the number you buy is not the price but the quantity you want. Thus, it shows that demand for that product is perfectly elastic. E.g., pure water, sweet. Most of the time, if you want to buy sweet or chewing gum, you just get to the person selling it and say, oh, give me 3 chewing gum. You hardly ask for the price. Why? Because the price for the product is so cheap and they sell it everywhere. And so your demand for that product is not determined by the price of the product, but by the quantity you want. So any product that behaves that way, it shows that the demand for that product is perfectly elastic. That's the meaning. And so it's from there they brought out perfect market, from perfect elasticity of demand. Now, having said that, of course, you know that we have different characteristics of perfect markets. There is free entry and exit. What that means is that any type of business that anybody can start at any time, and anybody can stop doing it at any time, is a perfect market. Then another thing is that homogeneous product. The products sold in perfect market are always homogeneous. They are the same. Then there are many buyers and sellers. Any product that you have plenty of people doing it, selling it, and plenty of people are buying it, is also a characteristic of perfect market. Of course, in the short run, in perfect market, the producer makes abnormal profits, and in the long run, it makes normal profits. So all of these ones are what I expected you to be familiar with. And of course, you know, in the short run, the core of the perfect market is this MC, and price equals to average revenue equals to demand. So this is the short run curve of a perfect market. And of course, the long run curve is when you have this. So the long run curve is showing that what we make the producer to make plenty profit is economies of scale. All of these are what you have done in year one, year two, year three, and so on. So, but right now, we now want to focus on supply function of a perfect market. Supply function of a perfect market. Now, we said aggregate supply function of a perfect market is given as this. Let's explain this. Anytime you say aggregate, it means total. That is, for example, let's assume you have one supplier of pure water. That is individual supply function. But when you now have 100 supplier of pure water, and let's assume it is 100 of them that are only supplying in that place, their supply function is what we call aggregate supply function. So aggregate is talking about every supplier in the market. So we are now saying that the supply function at the supply function of a firm, this I here is representing the number of suppliers that you have. So it might be that you want to look at the aggregate supply function in University of Lagos, or let's say Yaba local government. Let's say in Yaba local government we have 50 people that used to supply pure water. So this high will stand for 50. So we are trying to say supply function of the number of people that are supplying that thing. So it's equal to summation starting from 1 to n. N is the number of suppliers. So if I have 10 suppliers, 1 to n. If I have 50 suppliers, 1 to 50. So we now say that the supply function of our aggregate market is the summation of all the supply function of the supplier in that vicinity. So what I'm saying in a nutshell is that if I want to get supply function of 10 suppliers in a place, I will have to add all their supply function. This sign means addition. Addition of all the suppliers' function in that environment is equal to the aggregate supply function, which is the same thing as this. Now, why do we have P? We are saying that that supply function is a function of price, is subject to price. Don't forget, law of supply says that the higher the price, the higher the supply. A supplier will always supply at higher price. Why? Because he wants to make money. So, the higher the price, the higher the supply. And the lower the price, the lower the supply. Okay? Now, look at supply points. What is this one explaining? This one is explaining that there will be a supply, a supplier will supply. Let me interpret it in English. A supplier will supply provided that the price of that product is greater or equal to minimum average variable cost. Let me explain that in a layman's language. Let's assume there is a man producing pure water, and then he produces 10 pure water, just 10 sachets of pure water, and it cost that man to produce one pure water for 50 naira. So you know he produced 10, so 50 times 10 would be 500. So he used 500 to produce 10 pure water, so he produced one at 50 naira. Now, you can take this 50 naira as average variable cost. Let's remove the rent of the man. You know, the man will have a building where he produced the water. Let's leave the rent. Let's just look at what does it cost the man to produce one pure water, 50 naira. So what this thing is saying is that this man can only sell the pure water at a price that is equal to 50 naira, or at a price that is more than 50 naira. He can't sell below 50 naira because we run at loss. So price must be equal to 50 or greater than 50. Why? Because that's the cost that you produce one. That's what this one is saying. But there is no supply. You see, S I equals zero. Provided that price is less than minimum average cost. Meaning that if he produces it for 50 naira and then he has to sell it for 40 naira, the price is 40 naira. You can see that price is less than average variable cost. He can't supply. There is no supply at that point. And that's why you say supply is equal to zero. Because nobody wants to supply a product at a loss. And then, you know, that is why in a perfect market, if you are producing a product, you have to be sure of the market price because you can't sell above the market price. So if everybody in the market is selling pure water at 40 naira, you cannot come with your own pure water and sell it at 50 naira, even though it costs you 50 naira to produce. So what that means is you can't supply, nobody will buy from you. Why? Because in a perfect market, everybody have perfect knowledge of the market. Everybody knows the price of pure water. So you can't cheat anybody. You can't say, this is my own pure water, it's so powerful. I label it with gold. If you drink it, you will transfer to heaven. Preach from morning to night, nobody will buy the pure water. Why? You have to sell at the price that other people are selling. Why? Because that's a perfect market. You have to sell at uniform price. So if the price you produce is more than the price in the market, then you can't supply. That's what this is saying. And so all of this now, we are going to put it into calculation. So we are going to solve that question. This is a typical exam question under perfect market. And then before we go there, we now have profit is maximized when MC equals price. In perfect market, you must understand this. It's very important. That the producer will maximize profit at the point where marginal cost is equal to price. What that is saying is simple. That is, the producer can be making profit from his business, provided that the additional cost, of course, is equal to the price that he is selling. So that is, he is not making loss, he is making profit, he is making money. Okay, having said that, we are going to look at this question and then try to solve it. Now, we are given a cost function. And they say we should derive the supply function and then find the minimum average cost. And then they are asking us, should the firm supply if price is 5 naira? So for us to know whether the firm should supply, what that means is that we need to get our average variable cost. So once our average variable cost is less than price, then that means it will supply. But once average variable cost is more than price, then that means the supplier will not supply. Okay, now look at this question. Given that cost, because C means total cost, if they just write C, it means TC, which is total cost. This I that we have there is talking about the number of firm, number of supplier. So don't let that I confuse you. They are putting it there to explain that the number of supplier for that question is not given. It could be one, it could be two, it could be any number. Okay. Then the Q means quantity. So how do you get the supply function solution? So how you get the supply function? Now you have your CI to be 0.1 QIQ minus 2 QI squared plus 15 QI plus 10. So the first thing is you will differentiate. You will differentiate this total cost function and find the marginal cost. So don't forget that your marginal cost is differential of your total cost with respect to Q. So you want to differentiate this function with respect to Q. Don't forget, this is total cost. It's the same thing as total cost. So let's differentiate this now. Now to differentiate this, I'll have 3 times 0.1. That would be 0.3. Then you will minus 1 from the 3. So you have PI squared. So that's how to differentiate. Then let's differentiate this one. 2 times 2.
That will give us 4QI. Because 2 minus 1 will give me 1.
So there's no need for me to write the 1 here.
Then differentiate 15Q. It will give me 15.
So, and then when you differentiate 10, it will give you 0. So that one is gone. Okay, so the next thing is that you will now say profit is maximized.
Profit is maximized when XC equals P. When XC equals P. So our XC is this answer we have just gotten. So we now say 0.3 QI squared minus 4QI plus 15 is equal to P.
You see that? My marginal cost is this. So this marginal cost is equal to price. I don't know the price, so I put P here. So from here,
I can say 0.3 QI squared minus 4QI plus 15. This P is having invisible plus beside it. By the time it crosses over equal mark, it will change to minus P equals to 0. Because nothing will be at that side again, so it will be equal to 0.
Now, anytime you have Q squared, and then you have Q, and then you have a constant, that's a quadratic equation. So this is looking like a quadratic equation. So, and because it's a quadratic equation, so you are going to use your quadratic formula, which is minus b plus or minus square root of b squared minus 4ac over 2a. So this one now is going to be your supply function. Whatever you get here will be your supply function. Given that your a will be 0.3, your b will be minus 4, and your c will be this 15 minus b. So here now our a is 0.3, our b is minus 4, our c equals 15 minus b. The coefficient of q squared is always your a. Coefficient of q is always your b. And any other thing standing alone that does not have q is always your c. So that's what I've done there. So now that I know my ABC, I want to substitute it in this quadratic formula. They used to call it almighty formula. I don't know who named it almighty. So our supply function, of course, for the Fed, I can say supply function for all the Fed in that market will now be equal to minus B. So minus minus 4. Why is it minus minus 4? You know in the formula what you have is minus B. So the minus in the formula is this minus. Then our B is minus 4. That's why you have minus minus. Then plus or minus, I'm following this formula. Square root of minus 4 squared, because our B is minus 4. Minus 4A, what's our A? 0.3. 4AC, what's our C? 15 minus B. All over 2 into brackets, 0.3. Because what we have is 2A, and our A is 0.3. You see that? You see that? Yes, you can. If you have any question, reserve it for me. Call the number on the screen and you'll get to me. Okay, so here now, our supply function will now be equal to minus times minus will be plus, right? 4 plus or minus square root of minus 4 squared means minus 4 times minus 4. What's that? 16 minus 4 times 0.3. 4 times 0.3 is 1.2 into brackets 15 minus p. Let's leave it minus 1.2, yes.
So into bracket 15 minus b, all over 2 times 0.3. 0.6. What's your question, baby? You are fine. Okay, are we good to go, please?
Yeah.
Now, so from here, our supply function will now be 4 plus or minus square root of, look at the way I'll treat this place, 16 minus 1.2 times 15. Give me a figure. Minus 1.2 times 15. Minus 18. Then minus 1.2 times minus p. That will be plus 1.2p. Do you see that? Minus 1.2 times 15 will give me minus 18. Then minus 1.2 times minus p will give me plus 1.2p. All over 0.6. So my supply function will now be 4 plus or minus square root of 16 minus 18 is minus 2. So minus 2 plus 1.2p all over what? 0.6. But if I want to write this very well, I can now write it that my supply function is 4 plus or minus square root of 1.2p minus 2 all over 0.6. So this is the supply function. I did not do any magic. This plus 1.2, I brought it here. This minus 2, I take it to the back. That's why you have this over 0.6. So we have gotten the supply function. So the next thing we want to look at is to find the minimum average cost. Minimum average cost. Okay, I hope you enjoyed the class. So for more of the videos on advanced micro, production economics, advanced statistical theory, advanced mathematical economics, and many more, contact the number on the screen and you are going to be enjoying your classes on the go. Whether you are on the bed or you are chilling out somewhere and you feel you need to learn, you can be learning right there through your phone and you are going to enjoy it. Another advantage you have is that past questions are solved on each of these courses, apart from the fact that the topics are duly treated. You are going to love it. All you just need to do, call the number on the screen and you are going to be fine. Till I come your way again, I remain Simplified Lekeli. There are some other free videos which you can enjoy. All you need to do is go to Simplified Lekeli on your YouTube, click on subscribe and the bell button, and anytime we drop video, you are going to be enjoying it live on the go. Thank you.